He's about 455 yards away. He's going to hit about a 2-iron, I think.
This is the School of Motion podcast. Come for the MoGraph, stay for the puns. The guest for this episode is one of the coolest, most interesting people I've ever had the pleasure of talking to in my entire life. So Lilian Darmono is an illustrator, a character designer, an art director, an all-around creative person, currently living in London. And, you know, when I see her work and when I see other artists of that caliber, I really feel like they have some sort of voodoo black magic secret that I don't have. Why is it that they're able to create images that look so beautiful and come up with these ideas and these executions that are so polished and so professional? And maybe you can hear it in my voice that I get frustrated when my own work falls short in my eyes. And so with Lilian, I was really excited to dig into specifics. You know, how do you draw well? How do you design well? What are the secrets? You know, I mean, that's what I'm all about. I'm all about the shortcut. How do I get the secret? And spoiler alert, there is no shortcut. There is no secret. Although I did get Lilian to give us some really good actionable tips. And then we got serious. We actually talked about some big issues in our field and in life and in general. And I really hope you enjoy this interview. So here, without further ado, is Lilian Darmono. So Lilian, thank you so much for taking time to chat with me today. I really appreciate it.
No worries. Nice chatting to you.
Rock on. So I have a little sneak preview here that you sent me of some presentation slides that you're going to be using at Faux Images next Tuesday, which is September 1st, 2015, for anyone who's listening. And the first slide says, the Australian/Indonesian Chinese woman. I thought that was great. Like, so how much, you know, because I've read a lot of the things you've written, the stuff you've written on Motionographer, and your work has that sensibility. How much has your background influenced the work you do?
I think as I get older, I think it's getting more and more that case, because there's all these things that have come into my system without me even realizing it. For example, when I was growing up, I had access to all those European storybooks that you see in that presentation, and some of them I still have with me. And so at a very early age, I fell in love with watercolor illustrations, things to do with gardens and fairies and leaves and plants and flowers. And when I moved to Australia as an adult, they have a really famous series of illustrations called, I think it's called Gumnut Babies, or one of those things where if you see, I think you can Google it, and it's like babies, little babies that literally wear a certain kind of plant as their hat. So it's really, really cute. So that sort of stuff kind of came into my system without me realizing it. And all my life, I think I've spent so much time and energy trying to fight against that nature, trying to fight against things that come naturally to me. I don't know why, but it's one of those things that you do when you are young and you got told that this is who you need to be, this is what you need to do in order to make money. Sometimes you do those things. But also the Indonesian art and folk art has a lot of really intricate lattice work and motifs and a lot of traditional brush work, and a lot of that is starting to come into the way I paint. When I'm really, really stressed with work, a lot of my work is digital, so everything is computer based. When I'm really, really stressed with work, as a downtime, you know, something to have a break and really rest and relax, I would do watercolors. And as I get older and older, the watercolors tend to get more and more intricate. So I really can get lost in the brushwork and playing around with just pushing, you know, pools of water back and forth across the page, and that really calms me down. So yeah, that's the answer, I guess.
You make it sound very calming. I kind of want to go push water around on the paper now.
So one
of the things that, you know, I like to really dig into the talent that you know, people I get to interview have. And it's right before this interview, I was actually watching this little documentary on, I don't know if you've ever heard of him. His name is Jake Weidman. He's the youngest master penman in the world. And he's one of those guys.
I saw a post about that on Facebook.
It's incredible. You'd love it. He's one of these guys that uses an old fashioned pen and spends, 3 months on one piece, and it's super intricate. But one of the things he says, which I thought was really cool, is one of the longest, oldest romances is between the eye and the hand. And when I heard that, it made me feel horrible, because I constantly criticize myself for being a horrible illustrator. I really am down on myself about my drawing abilities. And one of the most basic things is just my hand will not do what I want it to. And when I see illustrators and art directors, like yourself, who really have a lot of control and a lot of ability, I wonder, how did you get that? So I was wondering if you could kind of walk through your development as specifically an illustrator, and then later on we'll dig into the art director part.
Yeah. So when I was about 17, 18, when I was doing the last 2 years in high school, I managed to get into a foundation program. It's supposed to be one of those prestigious art programs that is, marketed at people wanting to pursue a degree in design or art. And it teaches you all the basics from life drawing, color theory, the rough, really, really rough foundation of graphic design, as well as visual critique. And that's when I think my first hand-eye brain coordination training began. So we had to look at things and train our eyes to see things properly. Like, I remember one exercise was about painting everything that's white. So the teacher would set up a still life that is a white box, and there is a white bowl in it, and there is a white cloth in it. And she said, it's not just white. You can see if you train your eyes that some parts is slightly warmer white, some parts are slightly colder white, and we have to paint that. And she's a very, very harsh teacher, so everyone's terrified of her. So everybody, it's kind of torturous, really, in a way. But looking back, I'm very grateful for that sort of training. Now, unfortunately, I sort of abandoned that hand-eye coordination thing when I started graphic design. So all throughout my university years, that got sort of pushed aside as, my education basically concentrated on everything that's digital. So we didn't have any life drawing, we didn't have any sketching, and I just sort of abandoned the drawing stuff, and I didn't really pick it up again until I was about, maybe about 27, 28, right before I moved to London. To be honest, at that stage, I was more of a motion designer. I wasn't much of an illustrator at all. But because when I first moved to London, there was no work. So I had to do my own personal project in order to keep myself sane. And that's when I started doing digital style frames. I made this piece that's just for fun, and I put it up and put it out there, and sort of got my website together, including that personal piece. And not long after that, I was hired to do my first style frame job for a company here in London, and then it sort of kind of continued from there. And then not long after that, a year later, someone introduced me as an illustrator, and it's like, oh, okay, well, I guess I am now. And it's been really hard. I think it's one of those things that if you take it for granted and you don't keep practicing to keep your skills sharp, it can just, your brain and your muscles will just atrophy. And it's something that you need to constantly be on top of. It's just hours and hours and hours of practice. And there's tons and tons of people out there who are just amazing, who could indicate form and shapes with just three little strokes, and it's something that I can't do. And it's people like that really inspire me. But yeah, I think when it comes to illustration, it's just grunt work. You just have to keep practicing. It's just the hours you put in, really.
Got it. I mean, that's unfortunately what I suspected you would say, is that it just takes a lot of practice. I'm curious though, because I find with other things there is usually, I'm not saying shortcuts, but there's usually some technique or some exercise that can really kind of jumpstart things for people. For example, I'm an animator. That's really what I know the most about. And so you know, it when I taught at Ringling, for example, we would teach students how to make a ball bounce. That's kind of the standard thing. If you can make a ball bounce look right in the process, you're learning 10 things. You're really like, you're getting a pretty broad overview of animation just with that one exercise. I'm curious if there's anything like that in illustration, like maybe drawing, you know, a still life that's everything is white, and maybe drawing nudes. But is there some exercise that you found over the years, maybe you had to do this at school, that really helped develop that hand-eye coordination quickly?
Yeah, a few years ago, I was actually talking to Ian Kim, who's a very talented illustrator and designer. I don't know if you know him. Do you know him?
No, I'm not familiar.
He's just really amazing, and I found him through Motionographer, and I started writing to him. I said, you know, you have a very amazing quality of line in your drawing. How do you do that? Do you mind giving me a few tips? What sort of books, you know, do you get some books and teach yourself how to do certain things? And he said, yeah, sure. The one thing that really helps him, he said, and I think this is quite true, is what you call blind contour drawing, where you put your pencil or your charcoal on paper, on a fairly large piece of paper, and then you put an object that you want to draw in front of you, not too far away, and you only begin drawing the line once you're convinced that the tip of your pencil that's actually touching the paper is touching the object that you're drawing. So you're kind of feeling the contour of the object without looking at what you're drawing at all. So never taking your eyes off the object, and you just do that and let your lines flow throughout the page. And I've done this several times, and I haven't done it for a long time now because of, you know, time pressure. But it's an exercise that can really drive you crazy, because some of the people that are really good at it and obviously have that hand-eye coordination thing down pat, they can draw something that looks accurate, whereas when I look down at my result, it would just be like scribbles that goes over and over itself, and I would just occupy one corner of the page instead of, you know, proportionally using the entire piece of paper. So that's one. And the second one, I guess, if that really drives you crazy and you really have no patience for it, as I did, just keep drawing nudes, keep drawing still lives, because there is something there that is really difficult to do, you know, because your eye looks at an object and your eye and your brain knows how far away that object is from you physically, because you have these two eyeballs that look at something, and then the parallaxing that those two eyeballs create in your brain somehow calculates distance, volume, and all that sort of stuff. And it's a very difficult challenge to try and map what your brain knows as a three-dimensional space and object into a two-dimensional drawing. So the process of life drawing and still life drawing, and whether it's nudes, whether it's just a glass of water or like a vase of flowers you have lying around at home, whatever it is, I think that's the one thing that if you keep doing that a lot, you're going to get really good really, really quickly.
That is brilliant. Thank you so much for sharing those exercises. The blind contour thing is, you know, I didn't know what it was called, but I have tried that before, and it's infuriating.
it just drives you crazy.
It really does, yeah. But I mean, I'm really fascinated by things like that because, you know, for example, we did a special event at Ringling once, which it was called Drawing Week. We just drew for a week, and it was very uncomfortable for me because I don't draw very much. And I was sitting there drawing. And I was drawing the way I always draw, which is with my wrist. And someone came over and said, you're supposed to draw with your whole arm. And I'd never heard that. And it made this huge difference. All of a sudden, I had all this control. And it occurs to me, there's like just all these little things that, you know, if you can put enough of those together, maybe you can get the ball rolling. And then you can tackle, you know, form and shading and you know, stippling and all these more advanced things. So did you always draw like when you were growing up, or was it really in high school when you started to focus on it?
I've always drawn since I could pick up a pencil. There would be like hours and hours of me being silent in the corner. Of course, that made my parents very happy that I didn't go around bothering them. But I would try and find whatever piece of paper is lying around and just draw. It will be like something that old packaging or whatever, you know, I was really little and just kept drawing and drawing and drawing. And Mom said, oh, why don't you, you know, why don't we send you to a drawing school, or like get some kind of after hours, after school, you know, private tutor or whatever, because our family is poor. I grew up quite poor. I said, why am I wasting money? You know, I don't like the idea of wasting mom and dad's money like that. And I just did not like the I don't know. I mean, to me, drawing is personal and it's fun. And I felt like once I introduce a private tutor or a school into it, then it becomes less fun. So I rejected the idea. It wasn't until I decided that I want to pursue graphic design as a career when I was about 15 or 16 that I tried very, very hard to build my own personal portfolio to get into that, you know, quote-unquote prestigious foundation program in high school. But it's something that I've always done, and I can't. It's who I am, really. I mean, it just comes as second nature.
And when you were, you know, drawing as a child, were you always sort of, I mean, were people always telling you, oh, you're really good at this, you've got a knack for this, or did you have to really develop it, you know, going to school and practicing and now doing it professionally before you started to get recognized for your talent?
Because I grew up in Indonesia, it's a very difficult country to survive. And as an Indonesian, the main thing that your parents want you to have is a stable career, something that will make you money, something that would, you know, widen that gap as far wide as possible between the poverty line and where you are. So drawing and art was never taken seriously. There is no such thing as recognition for my talent. It just doesn't exist, you know. It's just seen as a hobby. Oh, yeah, yeah, you can draw. That's cute. It's never something that came up as a, this is a possible career thing. And I didn't even know what graphic design was until a cousin of mine who's, I don't know, maybe 8 years older, decided to do graphic design in university. But I suspect it was because his grades wasn't good enough to get into engineering or something like that. He was always a troublemaker. And like, I think his mom was really glad that he picked something that's relatively easy and somehow still managed to get a degree in it, because, you know, it's a degree is more about the prestige of having a degree rather than it's a training for your career.
Right.
So it was never a question of, oh, you're really good. You should, you know, you have a knack for this. It was just like, oh yeah. Yeah. That's something you do to pass your time. That's cute.
Are your parents support? I mean, now that you've got some success and you have a career, I assume your parents are a little more supportive. But was that difficult, like to have this thing that you liked and you were good at it, but you weren't actually being told that you were good at it? I mean, what was that like growing up like that?
It sucks, because I think a lot of listeners out there, if you're Asian, you would identify with this. Asian parents never praise. If you do something good, you never get praised. If you do something bad, you get chastised to no end. You know, and that's just the kind of parents that my parents are. But the funny thing is they have been really supportive. They have never tried to tell me I should be a doctor. They never tried to tell me I should be an engineer or whatever it is. In fact, it was my dad who pushed me into art and design, because I was trying to decide whether I should take triple science as a major, meaning biology, chemistry, and physics in Singapore, where I somehow managed to get a scholarship to go to Singapore at the age of 14. And it's going to be a very tough course. And the way the Singapore education is structured is that you have to pick one, you can't pick both. You have to be either a science person or an arts person. And when it came to the choosing, I asked Dad, I was maybe about 15 years old, I said, do you think I should be a doctor, or do you think I should be an artist or a graphic designer? And my dad just bluntly said, you're not cut out to be a doctor. Let's get ourselves here. You're not cut out to be a doctor. It's not a diss, but I think he knows me to be a very sensitive person that will get really upset if someone dies, you know, someone I'm trying to save dies, or
right.
I fail. You know, if you fail, if you're a doctor and you fail at something, it's a very serious consequence. And I don't think my dad, felt that it's the right thing for me. It would just destroy me. So based on that, I decided to, you know, dedicate myself to pursuing graphic design, and the first steps of which is to get into that foundation course.
So when you were 14, you went to Singapore. Did anyone come with you, or was it just you?
We were shipped out as a batch of 26 students, 13 girls and 13 boys. It's an initiative of the Singapore government to give out scholarship to people in the Southeast Asian countries, because Singapore is was experiencing a massive brain drain. The population isn't reproducing to replace the aging people, and young professionals are really hard to come by. So what they did was they gave out scholarships with no attachments, no bonds, and they just kind of hoping that if we get to them young enough. I mean, some people even got sent out at the age of 12. I can't imagine leaving home at the age of 12. I mean, 14 was hard enough, but that's how they did it. They thought that if they got to people young enough, eventually people would start feeling like Singapore is their home and would want to migrate there because, I mean, let's be honest, in the Southeast Asian region, it's the best place to be because it has the highest standard of living and everyone else is relatively a lot poorer. So that's their strategy.
And was it a lot of culture shock when you moved there?
Oh, massive. Yeah. The first 2 years were absolutely hell. I remember when I was 14, first time I left home, my parents were very protective and very loving. And it was the first time I had to, you know, not figuratively speaking, first time I had to tie my own shoelaces. Not literally, but I remember the first boarding house I stayed in was like a prison. It was really horrible. There was no hot water. Food was served out in metal trays like in prison, and we would get the worst kind of, you know, I'm pretty sure it was stale. The bread was stale. We used to get fed baked beans and white bread every morning, and there's no choice about it. You just have to eat it, otherwise you go starving, right? And the rooms were cold and, you know, and just moldy, and it's just horrible. So the first year, I think I cried the whole time, and I kept going home every 3 months, and eventually I couldn't stand it anymore living in a boarding house, and I had to get mom to move me out, and my family, because like I mentioned before, my family's quite poor, so somehow they managed to scrape up their savings and paid extra money to put me in with in a homestay situation where I'm staying with a family but renting out a private room in a family home that's owned by a bunch of, I don't know, Singaporean family. And I moved from one lodging to another until I was about 16, I think. Was it 16? 16 or 17 when my parents basically said, look, we have no more money. You have to move back into the boarding school system again. I was still under scholarship at that time. Tough. You just have to do it. So the second time around, I made sure I picked a better boarding house because you're actually allowed a choice. I didn't know it when I first started out, but you're allowed to pick, and I picked a better hostel, which at least has hot water and has their own bathroom inside a room that you share with another girl. So it's kind of like the American system of living in dorms.
Right.
Everything was much better. The food was better. I was old enough now to have a bit of confidence. I started making friends, and it just became the best 2 years of my life. So, yeah, but, starting out was really, really hard.
Yeah, I can't imagine. And do you keep in touch with friends you made during that time?
Yeah, I still do. I mean, we all have really different lives now, but there's a few that, especially the last 2 years were, you know, real friendships, quote unquote, were formed. I still keep in touch with them, and I've seen some of them in person after not having seen them for, you know, 10 years or so, and it's great. So they're scattered all over the world. Some are here in England, some are in the US, some are in Singapore. So, you know, it's kind of like having a network all across the globe, really.
Yeah, it's a really, I mean, you know, hearing your story, I mean, it really just drives home how sheltered I was, and most people I know, frankly, I mean, don't have any sort of experience like that. And it's interesting to me. I wrote one of the things I wrote down when I started Google stalking you for this interview was that I see so much, like your work, so much of it, not all of it, but so much of it is just like painfully cute and beautiful and like really just fun. Like I was showing, I have two little girls, I was showing them some of your work and they love it.
And
I wanted to know where that came from. And now I'm wondering, like, you know, were you drawing during this kind of dark period, 14 to 16? And maybe is this kind of maybe a reaction to that? Where does that stuff come from?
Yes, I was. When I was 17 and 18, like I said, the last 2 years of school, you know, what I called to be the two best years of my teenage life, that's when I was in that foundation program. So a lot of my personal work at that time was quite dark. And, you know, I was the angsty, angry teenager painting, acrylic pieces, listening to Alanis Morissette, blasting really loudly. Portable CD player.
Yep.
I don't know if anyone's old enough to remember portable CD players, but I certainly had one. So everything was quite dark, and I was really anti-cute. I was angry, you know, the angry teenager. I mean, I had my outlet through art, and, you know, I had my friends and stuff, but there's still a lot of things that, you know, really made me angry, you know, because I was just that kind of teenager. So the cute stuff didn't happen until I was... Let me think. I was probably in my second full-time job in Sydney. At that time, I was 27. And the full-time job required me to do a lot of broadcast graphics, so a lot of glossy things, sports channels, flying lozenges and ribbons and glows and stuff. So I started doing cute stuff as an escape from that, because it's just something that I don't know, just something to do to comfort myself, because I really didn't like Sydney. I was just there because of the work, because I've been retrenched from my first job. I was really sick at the time, and the company was bought by another company, so I lost my full-time job. Really sucks, even especially when you're sick, you're really, really sick. And after that, I decided to move to Sydney because I got offered this other full-time job, which is great as a young designer. It's you know, having a full-time job, a staff position, and it gives you the security, and you get to pick up so many tricks in After Effects from people that you work with. But really, there's nothing cute about the actual work that I was doing, and it just drove me crazy after a while. So I started doing cute stuff on the side until we had our second creative director. She was really quirky. She's very different from the first creative director, who's still there, but because the company was doing really well, they were splitting the task between the two of them. And I got to work with her a lot, and she was really encouraging. She really liked all the cute, quirky stuff. And the company won a contract to do a whole bunch of broadcast items for one of the main television channel in Australia called the ABC. And she really liked the cute stuff, and she said, yeah, let's do some cute stuff. So she got me to make posters, little cute paper dolls that then gets animated on top of this girl playing guitar. I think I still have it somewhere on my Vimeo page, on my reel from back then. And that kind of became the first stepping stone towards doing cute stuff that is related to animation or motion graphics. But before that, it was just nothing. Yeah.
Just flying lozenges. I love
that. Yeah, flying lozenges. Yeah.
We've all done the flying lozenge commercial. Come on, admit it.
Yeah.
That's great. And just out of curiosity, what was it about Sydney that you didn't like?
Oh, everything. They have this thing in Australia where people say you're either a Melbourne person or a Sydney person. And another person said that if Melbourne is like Audrey Hepburn, Sydney is like Paris Hilton.
Oh, wow. That says it all.
which, I mean, to be nice and to be fair to people who love Sydney and people who are from Sydney, it's fine. I mean, you can like Sydney. There's plenty of things to like about it. You know, beautiful beaches and great weather and all that sort of stuff. But it's just not as cultured as Melbourne is, in the sense that you have to poke around a lot harder to find the alternative scene, you know, be it, you know, bars or cafes. And you, one of the things we used to complain about when we moved there, me and my boyfriend, who's now my husband, is that every single bar has a sports screen, and every single bar has a chrome sort of railing around the bar. There's nothing dimly lit or vintagey or kind of different, or it just feels like a place with no soul. And I hated how disgusting it is with like all the pollution. And the one thing I hate the most is the cockroaches. You cannot escape cockroaches anywhere in Sydney. And it was the first time I heard that. I thought, you know, like you just get some, you know, pest control people come over to your house, and then they do a roach bomb and everything will be fine and you don't have to do it ever again. But it's not. It's a 6 month, you know, it's a 6 month thing, or like a yearly thing, that you have to roach bomb your whole house. And it's just it's just really gross. And in summer, you can see them crawling all over walls outside, like in gardens. It's just, it just drove me insane. So we left. After 2 years, we left to go back to Melbourne for a little bit, and then we moved here to London in 2008. Yeah.
Wow. You're well traveled. Cockroaches all over the world. So let's get back a little bit into the actual production of this work. So, you know, so you're in Sydney and you're working at, it sounds like, sort of, you know, your standard motion graphics studio, and you're doing lozenge commercials, but you're also doing network branding packages, stuff like that. And you know, one of the things that an animator like myself and a lot of my fellow animators, we're always fascinated by people who can just make beautiful boards. It's kind of like a dark art, and at least it is to me. And so I want to dig into a little bit of how you approach doing stuff like that. So, for example, if your creative director says, let's do something cute, how do you have a process for coming up with what you're actually going to design? Like, because obviously before you design something, you have to have an idea. What's that process look like for you?
Well, first of all, we would have a conversation between, you know, myself as a designer or art director and the creative director and the client, whoever it is that's involved in the final outcome. We would have a proper conversation. And if there isn't one scheduled, I would insist on one. In which we would talk about what exactly are you looking for? What is your message? Have you got any visual references? Have you got a color palette? Have you got a mood board? And sometimes, depending on the timeline, it's not always possible to have a mood board or a storyboard handed down to me when I begin the work. But it's actually a lot better if those things are already in place, because you already know what the story is going to be, how it's going to be broken down into an animated sequence, and therefore you can pick one or two keyframes in which it's going to be really, really important to nail those frames right in order to set the art direction for the entire piece. But usually when someone says, let's do something cute, you go, okay, what do you mean by cute? Do you mean childlike, or do you mean naive? Is there a certain era? Is it to bring back some kind of childhood nostalgia? So you try and get as much answers from them as possible. Get them to talk about it, you know, ask lots of questions, and then throw back answers to them, throw back your own interpretation at them, is what I would call a verbal return brief. And after that is done, usually we would all leave that meeting with a pretty good feeling of what they're looking for. And when they don't know what they're looking for, then it's our job as the creative team to step up and say, I think this would solve your problem. What do you think? And, you know, usually clients don't know how to interpret anything unless you start giving them visuals. So that's when your confidence needs to really take over, and you just go ahead and make some visuals. And the visuals usually begin with sketches. Either I do it on the computer or on Photoshop directly, because there are some really amazing brushes that I bought of this guy called Kyle T. Webster. He sells some
legend.
Of
He's a legend, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So his pencil brush is my favorite, because the way it works, it just makes me feel like I'm sketching on actual paper. But because I'm doing it directly on Photoshop, I can just quickly change the scale of the head to the body, or move things around, or, you know, erase things. And there's, you know, let's not forget the undo button is there.
Oh,
you know?
God, yeah.
Yeah. Either that, or if I don't feel like sitting in front of a computer, I would sit down somewhere else, not in front of a screen, and just draw and then scan what I have and manipulate it, and then get it to a stage where I'm happy to send as first black and white roughs, either to the creative director or to the end client directly, depending on the job, depending on the pipeline that's been set up. And then after that, then I would start coloring things in roughly. And it depends on what the style frame is. I mean, I used to get asked to do a lot of photoreal collage mixed with illustration type of style frames. And that's when you start by, once your sketches are done, then you start looking for a whole bunch of, you know, images that you can use to, you know, let's say you need a hill with grass on it, then you start looking for high-res images on Google that is available that you can use. You can, you know, pick up the grass, pick up the tree. But most of the time these days, it's not that sort of stuff at all. So if it's vector, then I would start drawing the first pass of the artwork, and then sending it through at the end of the day or at the next work in progress meeting or whatever, and then just polishing it round by round. So usually if I have 3 frames to do, I would try and get, depending on the job again, I would try and get either a 20% completion on each frame, on all 3 frames, and then sending that across so they get a good sense of what I'm trying to build up. Or I would try and get 1 frame as finished as possible without getting too carried away in putting in the final touches and sending that across, see if they're happy with it or not. And if they are, then I can apply the same treatment and strategy to the other frames. So it really depends on what's actually required.
Thank you for walking me through that, because I think that's a really helpful example of like how, what does it look like, you know, like to actually generate an idea and then present it to a client. But I'm also curious about just, I don't know, what do you think about this? Like, you know, to some people that I've met, ideas just fall out of them. You know, they can't like go to the bathroom without coming back with some crazy idea. And then some people really have to sit there and suffer to get those ideas. And I'm curious, do you think ideas are sort of an innate thing that just some people have access to? Or did you have to spend a lot of time going through references and looking at other artwork and building up like a vocabulary in your head to allow you to quickly generate ideas? Because then you can sketch it. Then you can go into Photoshop and Illustrator. But you need that idea first. And I'm curious where you think that comes from.
I think just like everything else in human beings, it really depends on how your brain is wired. If you're a very... If you're a very quick thinking, creative, you know, quote unquote creative person, you're just bubbling with different types of ideas. It's because, you know, it's almost like having a fast rate of metabolism in your head. So you just keep churning through images that you've seen before. Like your synapses in the brain just reacts much more quickly with one another to produce something. Whereas if you're a bit slower, then obviously it's going to take longer and it's going to be a little bit more painful, and probably it's going to take you more time and more research material in order to come up with the same level of creativity as your neighbor next door, who's, you know, a lot quicker at coming up with ideas, you know, almost like they can just come up with stuff on the go by the seat of their pants, you know. I think it really depends on the person, but I believe just like drawing and painting, it's just like a muscle. If you don't train it, it's going to atrophy. So even if you're a quote-unquote a genius or a prodigy, if you get lazy, if you rest on your laurels and you never challenge, you know, the way you come up with ideas or the kind of things that you come up with, the kind of visuals that you want to produce, if you don't challenge that, then you're going to end up making the same stuff over and over and over again. I even see this tendency with myself. For example, because a lot of my work is character-based, when someone said, give me a businesswoman, you know, so she's a professional. And, you know, it really bothers me because I know the quickest, easiest solution is to draw a person with a bun on her head, business suit, you know, with its jacket or blazer that's dark colored. And I'm like, come on, is there not a better way, or is there not another way to express this than just going back to the same stereotype? Because I'm aware that why I do that is because a lot of the work I do is vector, a lot of the work I do is like really simplified, flat characters, so I have to shorthand. And I guess it's not entirely my fault. It's one of those things where as society or as consumers, we're programmed to understand quickly that that's a businesswoman if she has a bun or a bob haircut, you know, and it's just one of those things that you, as a designer, you pick up on that and you utilize it. But, you know, it drives me crazy when I start noticing things like that about myself. Like, come on, there must be other ways. There must be other things I can do to make it say the same thing without having to resort to the same trick. So that's why I'm constantly looking at people when I'm walking around or catching the train or going to, you know, wherever it is I'm going when I'm outside the house. I'm constantly looking at people, actually, because I want to know what they wear. I want to know how they style their hair, because it's going to come into my work. I just know it. It's just looking out for, quote unquote, again, inspiration, whenever and wherever I go, because I know I will need it.
Yeah, so, that's great advice, and I think it probably helps you keep it fresh too. Because I mean, yeah, like in your career, how many business women, businessmen have you been asked to draw? I'm sure dozens. So one thing I definitely noticed in your work, which was really impressed me, frankly, is just how different a lot of the styles are in your work. You know, it's pretty easy, I think, and it depends on what your ambitions are, but it's pretty easy to become, you know, like just known for one style. And whenever a client needs that style, they go to you, and that's great. And you can have a great career that way, but it may not be as satisfying. So I'm talking about, for example, you had some frames for kombucha. We're gonna link to all of these in the show notes so everyone can go look at them. But kombucha, AT&T, mm-hmm. Google, Heinz, all four projects completely different looking. Mm-hmm. And you know, not every designer, art director, illustrator has that ability or that capacity. And I'm curious, is that a conscious effort on your part, or is that just something that just comes out of you and you're just interested in different styles?
I think for me, it's actually very, very hard to narrow myself down to one style. I've been trying to do it the past couple of years because I like a bit of diversity in my life and my work, and motion and animation doesn't satisfy me. It's great, and it's gonna continue to be my first love, but I also want other things. I want my illustrations on plates, glasses, cups, curtains, cushions and all that sort of stuff. Children's books is another one of my ambition, whether it's educational or fictional or whatever. And the illustration industry is very different than the motion industry or animation industry. The illustration industry really relies a lot on agents, and agents are terrified of someone who does not have one style, who has slightly, you know, ever so slightly diverse, and they will run away from you. So that's what I've been trying to do the last 2 years, is to try and narrow it down to one style. And even then I get rejected time and time and time again because they think it's too diverse. They think it's just, oh, it's just too diverse. It's too diverse. And I just keep hearing it. So I'm at this point in my life where I just give up because I don't know how to restrict myself to one thing, because it would just drive me nuts. You know, I can't imagine. I mean, it sounds great at the outset because I thought, yeah, I can keep the diverse stuff with my animation things and the narrow stuff with the illustration work, you know, illustration as in, you know, we're talking about publication, advertising, the traditional illustration industry. But I know that this is going to be one of those things. It's partly my husband as well, who's always there as the voice of reason next to me. He says, you're going to kill yourself if this happens to you. This is going to be one of those things where you be careful of what you wish for, because when it happens, you're going to hate it. So, you know, just sit there, you know, you have to draw the same thing over and over and over and over again. You're just going to go bonkers. And I think he's right. And it's not, I think when it comes to coming into one style, I think a designer and an art director usually will not be able to narrow themselves down to one style. And this is what sets them apart from artists or illustrators, who are much more likely to be able to generate one style with great consistency and not feeling the horrible pressure of boredom. I mean, of course, it really depends on the usage of the term designer and which right. industry you're talking about. But in my observation, especially coming from Australia, where the industry is a lot smaller, you are expected to be diverse. If you call yourself a designer and you're in motion, you are expected to be diverse.
Let me ask you this. You mentioned, you know, children's books. I know that you wrote and published a book, Little Hedgie in the Springtime, which I saw the cover of it, and it's just so adorable.
I didn't write that. My husband wrote that, and I just did the pictures.
Oh, you did the pictures? Oh, it looks beautiful. And I also saw you have, like a lot of motion designers, actually, you have a store on Society 6. Yeah. Which is filled with a bunch of amazing stuff. And so I'm curious, like, is that sort of your attempt to subvert this old style, like, you know, agent system that really tries to pigeonhole artists? Or was that just more of an experiment? Like, oh, let me see what happens if I put some work up here.
Yeah, it's a bit of both, really. But if I look at myself and I think really hard about what is it that I really want, is I want my designs on products, I want my illustrations on products, then why do I have to rely on an agent? I can put it out there myself. I mean, sure, I don't make any money out of it. It's like if I sell a pair of leggings of Society 6, I earn maybe £2, which is like $4.
Right.
Imagine how many of those you have to make in order to support yourself for a month. And yeah, it's just not a money-making thing. But it's a great hobby. And the great thing about doing it that way is that you don't worry about supply chain, you don't worry about stocks. Because when we were in Australia, when I last spoke to you, we had a small artist stall in the art market in Melbourne, and it was really fun, but I had to be there every Saturday, come rain or come shine, shivering in the cold, sweating in the heat, and we had to sort out our own material. We had to organize the printing. We had T-shirts. You know, we still have lots and lots of T-shirts that we didn't manage to sell because there's a minimum order that, you know, if you order less than that, they wouldn't do it for you. So it's a lot of stress. The merchandising side of things is not worth it. So I thought, fine, I don't make any money, but it's a great thing. It's just that satisfaction, you know, more than anything else, more than the money. It's a satisfaction of seeing your illustration on a physical object that you can touch. And we have a couple of cushions at home with my illustrations on it, and a shower curtain with my illustration on it. And I think that's enough, you know, I'm happy. It really doesn't make me any money at all, but it's just, yeah, it's good.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. You know, you don't have to get too specific, but I was curious how much income that actually brings you, and how important do you think it is to think like an entrepreneur, as a motion designer today?
How important it is to be an entrepreneur?
Yeah, because I mean, that's what you're doing. If you're putting your products out there for sale outside of the traditional, you know, motion design studio, cable network kind of world that you typically work in, you're branching out. It's, I mean, that is a mini business that you're sort of engaging in, you know?
I don't think of it as a business.
Maybe I'm projecting. I don't know.
Maybe. Look, I know a lot of people have done that. I have a friend who makes Cinema 4D plugins.
Yep.
And he's been pretty successful on that level. And I think that's great. I think it really depends on who you are. I think it takes a certain kind of personality to be able to do that, because it's not the easiest thing in the world. I mean, you might think that doing client work is difficult, but wait till you're selling your stuff directly to the public. You know, I've had people walk past my kiosk and say, yeah, that's kind of okay, but why would I buy that? I wouldn't need it. You know? No. Like, she was saying that to someone else she was walking with, and it's just, you know, the public can be really harsh critics, and especially in today's market where you have social media, you have that added pressure of getting as many likes as your competitor, it can be very demoralizing. But if you have the tenacity to do it, then sure. I mean, it doesn't mean that everybody, it's the right thing for everybody, I guess. But if you do have the spare brain power to do that, then yeah, sure, why not? Because I think restricting yourself to one thing is, I mean, if you know, why do that? You know, I certainly didn't. And I hope that if people have the urge to start their own little business doing whatever it is they like, then they should.
Well, I'm really big into coffee mugs, so I'm going to order a coffee mug with one of your prints on there for sure. All right, let's get back a little bit into a little bit more of the geeky stuff. So, again, you know, I mentioned that to me, design, it's something that I feel like I can fake. You know, I have no education really in it. And you know, the best designers I've worked with, they make it look so easy that I sometimes wonder, you know, is a design education necessary, or do you just need to be wired that way? Do you just need to be born with that gift? So I'm curious, first of all, do you think people are born designers, or are they made designers?
Nope. No one is born designers. Ever. Ever, ever, ever. I don't believe in that. I think it's a lot of training. I think it's a lot of sweat and a lot of painful times in university or whatever education that you want to put yourself through, whether it's self-education by reading books or experimenting, but it's education. Education doesn't have to mean that you go through college or university. Education can mean reading books and coming up with sketches yourself, you know. But one of the things that was really useful for design, because to me design is problem solving, Someone comes up to you with a problem. I need to say this in 30 seconds. And this is the kind of stuff that we have to stick to. These are the parameters. Can you help me make something? That's problem solving. I mean, when I was in university, I thought that the term design is problem solving is just disgustingly wanky. But now, more than ever, I think it's so true. That's what we do, you know? We're not here as artists. We're being paid to provide a service. And one of the things that really, really came in handy in my current job as a problem solver was when I was forced to come up with all kinds of crazy stuff at university, very, very difficult briefs. One of the things that we had to do was to think of everyday objects and then draw them in such a way that they would defeat their original purpose, if that makes sense. It's kind of inspired by my lecturers. My lecturer was inspired by the 1980s Japanese artist Shigeo Fukuda. He's the master of illusion, and one of the things that he did was lots and lots of posters with that sort of visual puns. So you, for example, you would have a poster where it's just flat color and there is a cannon barrel in it, but instead of the bullet, or you know, the ammunition pointing the right way, it's actually pointing into the barrel itself. I think that poster was made for a peace march or something like that.
I'm looking at it right now. It's brilliant.
Oh, yes. Yeah. So he showed us this stuff. I have never heard of who Fukuda was, but it was one of the hardest assignments I've ever had to do in my whole life. I sucked at it. I think I got a D or something. I don't remember what it was, but I didn't score very well in it. But it was through that process that my brain was trained to think in that way, to, you know, think outside the box and really go through the painful motion. It was really, really painful. And throughout my first few years coming out of university, I had my first job was as a graphic designer. I had to do that many, many times, especially with logo briefs. Logos are the hardest. It's so difficult. How do you sum up the essence of a company and somehow manipulate the letter forms or the graphic symbol that represents the company in such a way that it's visually appealing and clever? And my first boss, it was actually an internship, my boss, he was a genius. He's just a master at it. And just looking at him come up with those ideas, I was just floored. Like, how the hell did you do that? You know, so inspired by him, the first few years, although my first love is illustration, but somehow I sort of denied myself and became a graphic designer. But watching him do that was amazing. And I sort of went through the same process, how painful it was when I was working for him. But looking back, I think, wow, you know, I first thought that those were wasted years because I wasn't doing motion, I wasn't doing illustration, but I would not be the person that can solve problems the way I need to today had it not been for those things, you know. So no one is a born designer. It's a difficult, painful training that everyone needs to go through, I think.
Yeah, and I think you're totally right. Learning to think, especially logo design, is a great example. I mean, because you have to be so clever and concise visually, just with simple visual language. And I think that that's definitely like half the equation of being a good designer. But then the other half is making an image that's nice to look at. And even if you took out the let's come up with something interesting to create an image about, even if you just said create, you know, here's your five elements, here's your color palette, you know, or if you didn't give me a color palette, it'd be even harder. I still find it challenging to like compose the image and choose the color palette and get, you know, a value structure that works. And I'm curious if, you know, doing those things now is just sort of unconscious to you, or do you still rely on things like the rule of thirds and, you know, thinking of color schemes like triads and split complementary and stuff like that? Like, how much does that technical stuff still come into play for you?
All the time. I mean, the fact that it's second nature now, it doesn't mean that those things do not come into play. They do come into play. It's just that you don't even call it that in your brain. You're just kind of moving things around and your eye, I mean, composition wise, you move things around and your eye sort of goes, yep, that looks right. No, that doesn't change this, do that, you know. So you're subconsciously applying the principles that you've already learned. When it comes to colors, which is one of the things I love, it's a little bit more obvious. Like, I can hear my brain telling myself, okay, if the primary color is red, the color palette is red, if you want to make something pop out, then we use the complementary, which is the green or the blue or the cyan, you know. That still happens in my head. Yeah.
Got it. All the that training is drilled into you deep enough that it still comes back out. I mean, color specifically, I know that's something that a lot of people struggle with, because it seems like some people are good with color and some aren't. And why do you think that is? Do you think it's actually a technical skill to become good at combining colors and creating palettes, or is it more of an intuition thing?
Ooh, that's a hard one. I think there is something to the notion that your yellow isn't the same as my yellow. You know, that whole thing, the scientific thing behind it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
That everyone kind of perceives color differently. And also, scientifically, more males are more likely to be colorblind than females. And it's one of those studies that is obviously it's hard to be 100% conclusive, because you can't sample the entire world. But there is a notion that women are better at colors than men and things like that. I don't know how true that is, but I don't know. That's a really hard one. I am a believer that if you train yourself hard enough, visually, anything is possible, because it's just like doing light drawing or anything like that, where it's really come down to just hand eye brain coordination. That's it. That's all there is to it. The difference between a novice and a high level professional is just the number of hours that the high level professional has had to put in to get to that stage. And I think anything is possible, but again, I think some of it has something to do with the way your eyes and your brain is wired. So some people don't perceive color the same way as others.
So that's a perfect segue. Thank you for doing that. You know, one of the things that was interesting to me. So, you know, a while back I had to do a job for Progressive Insurance, and they have that spokeswoman Flo, and we had to create an illustrated version of her. And my art director was telling me, because, you know, we needed to hire an illustrator to do it, and he was very adamant that we hire a female illustrator. And he's a trained illustrator, and he said, you know, women see things differently and they draw things differently. And it never occurred to me that might be the case. I'm curious, you know, because you mentioned that there's a thought out there, true or not, that women might be better with color and more men are colorblind than women. Do you think women actually see art differently and see the world differently, and that comes through in their art?
Well, for example, the Oculus Rift, it's been known to make women dizzy. More women are likely to be dizzy wearing it, using it, than men. So that's something that nobody expected. Nobody thought of it. Nobody thought this would be an issue. But it's true. So there must be a way to finding out that I'm sure the scientists are working on it right now, but there must be something to it, that there's a slight difference between, you know, I don't know what it is, the refresh rate or whatever it is that connects your eyes to your brain that is affected by the Y chromosome. But it's one of those very difficult things, because if, you know, I know that a lot of people would be really wary about saying things in relation to gender, because they don't want to be seen as sexist or you know, have preconceived notions about what is suitable for men and what's suitable for women. I don't know. But as a woman, I have to say that, yeah, I think there is a certain difference in the way we see the world. For example, in the article that I wrote for Motionographer about not letting the model out there, because the industry is predominantly male.
Sure, yeah.
Let's not let that model of how you define success affect you if you're not one of the majority. It's I guess the way you see it is like in the world, it's all about climbing up higher and higher. So there's a vertical structure. Whereas as a woman, I find personally that I'm a lot more satisfied when I have a more rounded, you know, well-rounded sense of achievement. So life is going well, work is going well, I have time to see my friends, I still find time to, you know, look after my cats and things like that. So I think that way of seeing the world and seeing what achievement and success means to you if you're an artist, that's going to come through in your art, and that's going to come through in the way you see the world. That's going to come through in the way you express yourself. So I can't speak for everyone else, and of course there's always going to be exception, because you can't just define people by binary gender to begin with, let alone define people by how they see the world based on that binary gender. So I think, without, you know, making a blanket statement for everybody, for me personally, if I'm a woman, this is how I see the world, and I see that as a different thing than how my male friends see the world and express themselves in their art.
Totally. And just so it's out there, I know we're kind of walking into a minefield here, so but I like this. I totally, when I read the Motionographer article, I was just nodding my head the whole time. You know, in my experience, you know, coming up and freelancing and working, there were very few female motion designers around me, and it was very much a boys' club, and it was definitely that stereotype of, like, all, you know, all the producers are women, and the editors and the animators are men. And I, you know, one thing that reassures me now is, you know, having taught at Ringling and now teaching online, I mean, it's getting close to half and half, men and women. I mean, it's really coming up. There's some amazing talent out there. And, you know, it's again, we're talking about the minefield. You know, sometimes when you compliment someone and you, like, make a list of, like, really good women designers or motion designers, it almost becomes sexist, because you're, like, you're making a list. So I just want to, like, you know, just so it's out there, disclaimer, like, these are all very talented people. Doesn't matter what sex they are. But, you know, you've got Karen Fong, you've got Aaron Sarofsky, you've got, I would definitely put you in that category. You know, up-and-comers, Erica Gorachow is brilliant. There's a lot of role models, I think, that hopefully this generation of motion designers will be able to look up to, you know, female motion designers on the way up. And I'm curious if you felt that you had a lack of role models, and how that affected the way that you felt you had to behave as you were, you know, building your career.
Yes, I definitely don't have any role models up until I came up into Sydney and had that second job with that amazing female director. Her name is Marcel Lunem. Marcel, if you're listening, hello. she's fantastic. She was my first amazing role model. And before that, the women in power that I have come across, that I have had to deal directly, i.e. my creative output was judged directly by them, and I had to make changes based on what they say, have been awful, 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 awful people. They just, it's that really sad example of women in power being really bitchy and bossy and rude and mean, because they have had to fight so much, and they have to had to fight so hard to get to where they are. So they can't be, it's almost like they've forgotten how to be kind, or decide not to, to prepare you for the harsh world out there. So whether it's through neglect or through intention, the experience doesn't come across very nice for a young female designer coming up in the world to have that sort of role model. So, but the thing about me was that I was the younger sibling. There's two of us in the family, and I grew up with a brother who's a lot older. So for lack of a better word, I guess, better word, I've been a bit of a tomboy. So I find, you know, hanging out with men and working alongside men was sort of tolerable to a certain extent, until I became older, and it just started to be a little bit more difficult because of the awkwardness that comes up in like, for example, right now, if there is a motion design event in town in London, it's almost difficult for me to make myself go, because I feel like if I turn up, people are going to look at me and either assume I'm a producer. No offense for producers out there, but it's just the assumptions that I can't stand. They either assume I'm a producer, I don't know my way around After Effects, I don't know what I'm talking about, or I'm just someone's girlfriend. Whether that's just a chip on my shoulder or it's real, it's very difficult to say, of course, but it's quite difficult. And it, definitely not until I've read that article by Brenda Chapman, when she was first kicked off Brave, that she said something along, I've tried to find that article since, but I haven't managed to, but she said something along the line of, you know, as a woman in the creative industry, it's like you go to meetings and have your ideas ignored until they're spoken by your male counterparts and then suddenly get treated as gold. And that's happened to me personally. And it's very difficult reading that. It's almost like reliving a trauma. And it's just horrible. And I just don't want that on anyone. I don't wish that on anyone. It's really, really horrible, you know. And one of the discussions that's happened on Facebook, on Justin Cohn's wall or page, was when we were talking about diversity. A black designer actually said that when he comes into a motion studio in New York, the receptionist would say, "Dropping off or picking up?" And it's so horrible. It is so painful to hear him say that. And it's just, why do we do these things to people?
I know. I like to think, because, you know, I lived in Boston for a long time, very progressive, very liberal city, you know, very, very open. And so you can almost forget for a little while that we're not actually in a post-racial, post-discrimination world. It's still there. And do you, now, when you hear stories like that, do you think that that is conscious bias, or is it unconscious, sort of like ingrained in us by the way we were brought up?
I don't think that question really matters. I think a bias is a bias, and sometimes from observation, unconscious bias can hurt more than a conscious one, because it is so, especially when it comes to sexism, it is so difficult to spot and it's so difficult to call out. Because, you know, like a great quote by Michelle Higer, when we were talking about this, she said, don't attribute something to malice that which can be attributed to stupidity. So, and also this notion of having imaginary enemies, you know, how do you know when someone is, it's like, you know, when someone says something unpleasant or do something horrible, it's like, wait a minute, was I not included in that meeting because I'm a woman, or because they just simply don't have time, or there are other thousand other factors in production that I don't know of? You know, it's very, very hard to spot, to know for sure. And until you know for sure, we live in a society where until you know for sure, don't cry and say, you know, guilty. Because it's like, it's just, you know, you try and maintain peace at, you know, in a workplace and all that sort of stuff. So it's really, really difficult. So as someone that's experienced racism and sexism, I think a bias is a bias. And I think trying to split it, whether it's a conscious or unconscious, can be detrimental to correcting that bias. That's my personal feeling about it.
Gotcha. Yeah, I mean, I guess I wasn't, I definitely wasn't saying that it's more justified or less justified if it's unconscious. It's more the idea that, you know, like for me personally, right, I'm poster boy, I'm like, you know, privileged white male in America, grew up middle class, like, you know, I'm almost like a lot of Americans in my situation, I'm like overly self-conscious about being like incredibly inclusive to everybody. And even that sometimes makes me feel uncomfortable, like that's a weird form of bias. And so I guess the reason I was asking, do you think it's conscious or unconscious, is if it's conscious, there's nothing that can be done about it, really. If it's unconscious, there probably is something that can be done. And I'm curious if you have any thoughts on what, you know, what should we be doing different as, you know, as, for example, as parents. You know, I have two girls. You know, were there any things that happened to you as a little kid that kind of shaped you, that maybe, you know, maybe like landmines I could avoid with my kids, you know, I don't know, not buying them as many dolls, and, you know, buy these are questions that I think as a society we have to answer. But for me personally, I'm curious what your insight is.
I think you just do your best. I think the best thing you can teach your kids is to be humble enough to admit that they've made a mistake. To be humble enough to admit that they've got a bias, whatever it is. Because as human beings, we're never going to be perfect. As human beings, we're always going to have a bias. I myself, even though I'm a woman, I am sure that I have this bias deep inside my brain somewhere, that if a senior person is a woman, you know, because of my past experiences, if I'm going to be working under a woman versus working under a man, if everything else being equal, it would be nicer to work under a man, because, you know, he would be less likely to be bitchy and mean to me, blah, blah, blah. So it's a bias. I have that bias. And it's uncomfortable to admit it to yourself that you're biased. It's uncomfortable to admit to yourself that you're flawed. And I think that's the best thing you can do, really. I mean, everything else, of course, common sense, you know, you don't buy your daughter's pink toys or... But the thing is, you can go all the way too far and overly correct something. And feminism and gender equality is a complicated issue. I mean, if your daughter actually really likes pink, are you going to stop her from having pink stuff because you say, oh no, it's, you know, socially it's a stereotype to be pink, to be obsessed with pink stuff. I've drawn stuff in my 100 project thing with the cakes and the characters. I mean, sometimes I just like drawing pretty cakes with pink stuff, and then as a person that cake would be a girl with a pink dress. I've done that, you know. And I do say in my caption, you know, like sometimes the social justice warrior needs to take a break and just draw pretty stuff, and whether it's pink or blue or male or female, it's just, you know, I don't know, it's pretty, you know. So I guess consciously you just do the stuff that you know is going to help, but at the same time, it's always going to be a complicated thing. But the most important thing is to teach them to admit that they're flawed. And I think that's the biggest thing you need. That's the most important thing you need to have as a person if we were to progress anywhere, I think.
I think that's brilliant, brilliant advice. And just for the record, there's no way I could possibly stop my daughter from having pink things. It's like she was born loving the color pink. You know, so another thing, obviously, like the kind of the elephant in the room that it's a challenge that only women face is, you know, giving birth. And I believe maybe on Twitter or something, you've had a couple of comments where you've sort of asked people, like, you know, what's some advice for women? You're married. I'm assuming maybe one day you want to have children. And mm-hmm. and how do you think about that challenge? Because that is definitely a distinctly female thing. I mean, you know, I've seen childbirth, but that doesn't mean I know anything about it. and I'm curious, like, what are your thoughts on juggling that challenge, being pregnant, giving birth, and then being a mom with the, you know, the realities of this business?
Oh, it's absolutely frightening. And I don't know how anyone can do it, but I believe it can be done. That's the thing about the whole thing. It's like, if we stop seeing achievement as awards, whether it's Young Guns or DNAD, again, nothing against those award-giving institutions. I'm just saying that that's what's popular out there. If we stop seeing life as measured by those milestones, then we probably will be a lot kinder to people who apply for jobs who are planning to have children in the next year, in the next 6 months, or in the next whatever. It's actually really relevant in my life right now because, as you said, we are thinking of having children in the near future. I don't know whether it's a year or 2 years. It really is a bigger question out there, is whether do we move home to Australia, do we stay here in London, blah, blah, blah. But actually, my best friend who lives in the next building is having a bit of a tough time at the moment juggling motherhood and running a company. She and her husband have formed a small, amazing animation studio called Picnic in London. And at the moment, the husband is away. And she's relying on me. So I'm trying to help her look after the baby. And she's just the cutest little baby on the whole planet. And, you know, looking at her, my ovaries just explode. So right. it's not a chore for me. But, you know, I'm doing it also because I know how tough it can be. And she doesn't have any family here. And it can be really tough when you haven't got any families around or any relatives, cousins or sisters or whatever, or in-laws. And I think we need to help each other. And that's kind of what I'm doing this week while her husband is away. And it's kind of like why we probably should wrap up soonish so I could go over and help her bathe her little child. But it's crazy. But it's one of those things. Personally, I'm the kind of person that is too afraid of the future and too afraid of everything. I overthink everything, and I'm only just coming into a stage where I learn not to do that. So I think personally, I will not think of how difficult it would be, and I will just have to tackle it as it comes, because that's the only way you can get anywhere, it seems. So I'm just consciously, you know, shutting my mind off looking at the difficulties that my friend over there, Mina, is going through, and kind of thinking, oh my God, it's going to be so hard. I'm like, no, it's going to be fine. Just telling myself it's going to be fine. And yeah, hopefully it's just one thing at a time, you know, like it is an even bigger challenge though, because like there's not a lot of role models out there of women in motion and animation who have had to juggle both career and family. I know Naomi from Panda Panther is one, and yeah, we used to keep in touch a while ago, and I used to do some work for them, but I think they've taken some time off commercial work and started doing their own personal films, and I haven't heard from them in quite a while. But see, I mean, now her daughter is getting into that age of going to kindergarten and stuff, and they're still around, they're still doing great work. So I don't know, it's not, you know, it's nothing to be afraid of. And another great mother out there who's running a company with her husband is Softly with Darren Price. They're running Mighty Nice in Sydney. They're represented by Nexus here in London. And Softly has two boys and a girl and three children and all under the age of you know, 10 or 5. And I think the little girl is really, really young still. And she's still doing work. She's art directing, she's designing, she's illustrating, and I can't imagine what it must be like for her. But, you know, amazing, amazing ladies out there. There's just not enough of them, because maybe we need to be talking to more of them so younger women can see that it's fine, it's going to be okay, you know?
Yeah, I agree so much with you. I think that, you know, especially once you get to a point in your career, which I think you're definitely at, where you're going to have options that are going to allow you to juggle things that maybe, you know, a 20-year-old wouldn't be able to. You probably have a little more flexibility to dictate your schedule, especially you're a freelance right now, right?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, you find clients that are understanding, and you're, you know, especially if you're doing work. I know you work with a lot of U.S. studios. Mm-hmm. And with the time difference, you know, your hours are kind of shifted anyway. There's ways to make it work. I've seen it before. Yeah. It's definitely not easy, but but you know, nothing is when it comes to children, as you're seeing with your friend, right?
Yeah. I mean, you can have a full time job. You can be in another industry that's not animation. It can be just as hard. I mean, kids are just hard.
This is true. This is true.
You're a parent. I mean, you wouldn't trade those two little girls for anything in the world. It's totally worth it.
Exactly. Right? I have a little boy too. I actually have three, and they're all under the age of five. So, but I'm fortunate. I married Superwoman, and she she keeps it all straight for me.
Wow. Yeah, amazing.
My wife's incredible. Well, let's wrap it up with this. So, you know, you've had, by the way, thank you so much. This has been such an interesting conversation for me. It started off kind of going like on this world tour, and it got a little dark, and now we're like digging into social issues. I'm loving this. So I'm curious, like, what, you know, now that you're married and you've got this idea that at some point in the next couple of years you may have children. You've had, I don't know how you feel about it, but from my vantage point, it looks like an arguably successful career, and a great reputation and a great body of work. What's next for you? Like, what's your professional and personal goals in the next, say, 5 years?
Well, at the moment, I've started doing more and more art direction for kids' TV series. So, you know, nothing else more fitting, right? I mean, thinking of having kids and then doing more kids stuff. It's all cute. It's all amazingly clucky and broody. Yeah, so that's going to be the next challenge, I guess, because it's something that I haven't done much before in the past. In terms of the time turnaround, it's going to be longer. It's going to require more long-term thinking, and consistency has to go across everything in the next 8 months rather than 3 weeks. It's a huge difference. And continuing with everything else, I guess, you know, painting and drawing and putting up bits and pieces on Society 6 that makes me 30 cents per item or whatever it is. I don't know. I'm just happy, really. I mean, it's taken me a long time to be content with where I am in life and in work. And a lot of it is not external. A lot of it is internal. It's about how I choose to see myself and to see the life and the goals that I want to have in it. And a lot of it is thanks to my husband, who's always there to be supportive and also to be strict with me when he sees me doing things that hurts myself, like, you know, indulging in self-pity, indulging in despair, indulging in insecurity, because we're all artists. We're all going to be insecure at some point or other in our lives. That's just, it's something that I've come to accept as normal now, because everyone I've spoken to, no matter how amazingly talented they are, they would have those moments, and I think it's completely natural. And I'm probably not going to win any awards anytime soon, but again, I don't believe in that sort of system of measuring myself, because again, it's one of those arbitrary things. So yeah, I guess just trucking along and keeping everything in balance, life, work, and children, hopefully someday, and I don't know, we'll see what else comes up, I guess.
Awesome. Well, I am certain that you're going to be very successful at whatever you do, and I want to say thank you one more time for coming on and chatting with me.
No worries. Thanks for having me.
I'm really glad that this interview went where it did, and I really have to thank Lilian for not being afraid to kind of dig into her past, even the not-so-fun parts, and to talk about her fears, you know, around having children and still being able to work in this field. You know, these are all really kind of deep issues that it's easy to just kind of brush aside and kind of dance around, and especially the whole idea that motion design has been a sausage party for a very long time. But I do think things are starting to change, and I think that it's women like Lilian that are really helping to lead that charge. And Lilian is really now one of those role models that she wishes she had when she was coming up. She is now that successful, brilliant female motion designer that others can look up to. And, you know, there's a lot of up-and-coming motion designers who are brilliant in their own right. You've got Erica Gorchow, I'm a huge fan of. Alex Pope, brilliant Ringling grad. Amy Sundin, our own Amy Sundin. And I think that it's just going to get better and better, and there's going to be more parity and more balance in our field, which is definitely a good thing. I also really hope that you got a lot of interesting ideas and resources, and frankly, I can't wait to go practice some blind contour drawing and see if that makes me any more proficient. You know, that link between my eye and my hand is pretty crappy at the moment, so I'm going to work on that, and I hope you do too. All of the resources and the links and the artists that we talked about are going to be in the show notes on schoolofmotion.com on the page where this interview lives. So head over there and you can go through all that, click on the links, and get access to anything we talked about. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you to Lilian for being really, really generous with her time, and I will talk to you guys on the next one of these. Take care.